Let's change this up a little bit. I want to hear an impersonation of someone, anybody, as you introduce the players.
All right. So, in the top right.
Well, who are you impersonating? We have to know.
I was going to impersonate a GSL introduction.
Oh, nice.
So, okay. It'd be like, in the top right, we have, and there's like an awkward pause from Tasteless. Kawaii Light. And
that,
the bottom left.
That's really good.
We have Fnatic, we have Fnatic Moon. Fnatic RC Moon, excuse me. The Blue Zerg, the man from Warcraft 3. He is going to be called Fnatic RC Moona.
That's really good. I'm really, really impressed, man. God,
you don't know how many hours I spent in front of the mirror practicing that, man, spitting all over the place.
Because that is standard. Normally, when we try to hear each other, we go to the mirror. It's like, how do I do this effectively? I know, let's go to the mirror.
Yeah, let's go to the mirror, man.
Pretty standard, man. All right, so we have Antigua Shipyard. Kawaii Rice did pick this map, and I love this. Frodan, what are your thoughts on TVZ on Antigua Shipyard? Antigua Shipyard.
You know, I love it. A lot of people actually start going really fast third command center on this map just because it's easy, secure based off position. And if you can get, you know, those early siege tanks, you'll be able to secure your position. And we were talking earlier because I remember watching the show match last week on NASL about, you know, it was Maro versus Leenok. And you're talking about these middle gold expansions, which actually are on this map. And, you know, taking that position is very, very key. Kawaii Rice is definitely seeing that that's probably the late game goal. If you can secure that position, you're almost immovable because you can cover almost every area of your expansions. And, you know, I'm really expecting to see a lot of, you know, good play out of Kawaii Rice just because, again, he'll have an easier time penetrating the Zerg defense with Hellions because the ramp is so wide. So these kind of factors definitely go into play. But you know what, man? Moon's shown that he's capable of just making that quick counteract decision. He's been taking a lot of damage this early game, and I really want him to minimize that because I want a really long, drawn-out 30-minute game where both players are showing what they're capable of at all stages of the game.
Kawaii Rice is going for a gasless fast expansion, so changing up slightly. I like this change up. This is, again, going to mind game his opponent because he's shown reactor helling every single game. We're going to see a spine crawler, and it's a blind spine crawler that will be put down to counteract that. But, of course, the hellions won't be out for quite a long time. It's going to be delayed by a whole command center, which is somewhere around, I believe, like 30 to 45 seconds for a one base. And obviously that's going to help Kawaii Rice because his opponent is slightly less efficient than him. Oh, barracks goes down. Oh, excuse me. That's completely different than what I thought it was going to happen. But okay.
Me too, man. I thought he was going to go for that factory, which he did save up a lot of gas for. And looks like he's finally going to start just a little bit slighter. But, you know, what's the second barracks degree to it? What are the implications of what Kawaii Rice is thinking?
Well, the second barracks gives him power in this early push with Hellions, Marines, and Marauders, punishes something like a fast third a lot of the times, and that's something Kawaii Rice has seen several times his opponent doing that type of stuff. Obviously, that fast third is taken every single time directly after the Hellions are actually cleaned up. Actually, just game one, what am I saying? Game two didn't happen. So maybe he's preparing for something like that. I do like that type of style. We're going to have a very fast stim coming out from Kawaii Rice. And I like how he actually took one, or it looks like three SEVs off of gas and put them towards minerals. Very important to do in this particular build.
Yeah, it's it just mines a little bit more efficient than just three SCVs on one gas. So Kawaii Rice setting himself up very well. And I like how just so precise it is. He's actually making Marauders and ooh, that's the transition he's looking for, Hellions and Marauders, but he is making a reactor, so he's just going to mix it up his opening just slightly, and I like that. He's adapting his play, Gretorp, in a best of three series based off what he is, and, you know, he's going to be able to really capitalize on that. But the trade-off is that he won't have, you know, as many Hellions early on, and the fact is Moon actually sees the Marauder and the Marines, so, you know, Moon got some good information off of that. So both players playing a little bit differently. I wonder how Moon's going to react here.
I like what Moon just did. He threw down that Baneling Nest. That's so important, especially when you see that Marauder, but I'm sure Qualifiers actually meant for that to happen. Now you see the Marauder, you're saying, okay, well, you got a very early tech lapse. I have to be careful because Stim, Combat Shields, that's going to be upgraded a little bit prematurely. We don't normally see that. Now Qualifiers is going to poke in here. I would much rather him prefer to only show the Marines, and then all of a sudden he busts out in case his opponent does do an early third. But at this point, I think Moon, seeing that transition, should go into a macro hatch and throw down that Spire and have those 12-minute, 13-minute mutas instead of just the regular two base. And there it is! That macro hatch goes down. Booyah.
Yeah, and you know, this is actually a very Korean-esque style of play, which is, I mean, this everyone loves doing this. If you see players like Leenok, if you see players like Revival, and you know, even Dongregu, you know, all these great little players like to do these kind of macro hatches for two bases before taking a third. And Qualifiers is going to go ahead and harass a lot of these Zerglings, actually getting a lot of Zerglings. That's a huge play. He's going to have to make a lot of those Zerglings back. And he's also saw two more Hellions. Now, six Hellions can light up your mineral lines faster than a Kardashian marriage, man. So it's going to be really, really hard for Moon to hold this off if he's not careful.
Yeah, I mean, Moon right now isn't in a great position. Obviously, you want to clean that out a lot earlier. Spire is on the way. This will be the standard, still fast mutas out in the field. But not having that third going up is definitely hurting him quite a bit. And even when these come out, the mutas come out, he won't actually take map control because it should have it that, Combat Shield isn't actually upgraded. A little bit of a misstep for Qualifiers, but he should have had Combat Shield and Stim ready for his Marines, and then all of a sudden he has these Hellions and Marines ready on the field. He forces Banelings out of his opponent. He takes map control, and he doesn't have to make so many turrets in this early game stage. It actually gives him a much faster third, which I think Qualifiers, yeah, he already has his third command center out and about.
Yeah, so just like we were saying before, fast thirds are very prominent on this map just because of how easy it is to secure normally. Now, Moon is making a lot of Banelings, actually. He made a lot of Zerglings. 32 Banelings, Gretorp.
Oh, that is a lot of freaking Banelings. It looks like Siege Mode isn't even ready. So it's going to come down to a lot of micro at this stage. Now, good for Qualifiers. He does have his wall, the Supply Depot wall, but that's not going to last very long. What Moon, all he has to do is just connect both these. He's actually not going for the Spire tech anymore. He's completely given up in that. And Qualifiers, this could be... Oh, the Hellions, they're going to actually catch these Banelings. He sees the Sentry U hooks. And what can he actually do? Ooh, there's a big hit. Banelings are moving forward. And, oh, the Siege Mode is finished. Big hits on top of the Banelings. Sim goes up, and 32 Banelings absolutely get dismantled just like that in a matter of a couple of seconds.
I don't understand Moon sending a Banelings there without any Zerglings to tank shots or anything, no information whatsoever, and he just invested 32 Banelings for two Supply Depots, and that is probably the worst trade of all time.
Oh, yeah.
And I mean, Moon's even trying to take a third, and Qualifiers has the Engineering Blade blocking the third. Qualifiers got Moon on lockdown right now. He's got him completely red. And Moon, I can't believe he invested that much into just something that had no returns. And Qualifiers definitely has to be feeling confident after that.
To let you guys just understand a little bit, it's 32 Banelings. Each one is 25. So 32 divided by 4, it's 8. That means 8 Mutalisks died from that engagement for a price of maybe, you know, 4 Marines and 2 Supply Depots. Not a good trade, Frodan.
No,
I don't like those trades at all. Of course, Qualifiers is going to be able to get his expansion, gets his second factory up, and we're going to be seeing him just rile up in the amount of units that he has. He's going to get such a fast, I think, a 2-2 timing that he's going to have. A 2-2 timing is going to push out with a ton of Marines, ton of Siege Tanks, and Moon is just so underdeveloped at this point, I don't know what he can do.
Yeah, I mean, Moon's, you can see that his mutas should be way higher than 7 at this point. We're 13 minutes in the game. Moon's going to do only he could and double expand. He's going to take a little bit of a risk here just to make to try to catch up. And that's what he can do at this point. And he's droning up heavily. 13 drones are going to come out. And he's finally starting to somewhat even out the worker count. But Qualifiers got triple orbitals, Gretorp. And I mean, I know you do love doing math, but that is a very strong overwhelming advantage, especially if you're about even on workers.
Yeah, I have to agree with that. I mean, 3 orbital command centers gives you a gigantic, gigantic income advantage. Look at that income. It's just so pretty. Qualifier Rice. You know, he always yells at me for having such bad mule usage. Look at you, Qualifier Rice. 8 mules on the field. What's that? 3,500 mineral income? That's pretty standard.
That's absurd, man. He's going to be able to pump out Marines for weeks and months. He's actually getting sensor towers as well, a kind of an underutilized building for a lot of Terrans, just to be able to make sure he doesn't get counterattacked. Love that he's setting up turrets everywhere, making sure that this time he's going to be a lot more fortified in case any mules come, like the ones going into his main right now. But for the most part, no real damage can actually be done to Qualifier Rice. Now, Qualifier Rice actually does know that his engineering base is not contested at all. It's still there, so he has to kind of be suspicious of something because he knows Zerg does not want to stay on 2 base this long. So he's going to start have to hunt for expansions, start looking around the map, because right now, Moon's definitely trying to play really greedy and hope that Qualifier Rice is not going to discover him.
Couple meters are flying over to the third base, but there are Marines and turrets set up over there. I think Qualifier Rice, as you said, he should go and start looking. It looks like he's starting right now. First Marine going to the bottom right hand corner. He's going to see a lot of drones. That's obviously a big indication that he has that bottom right hand expansion. I actually love how Moon has actually started to take his expansion. I think this is the best way, actually, on Antique Shipyard. Instead of taking your third over here, you take it in opposite corners, third and fourth, really, and then you're able to keep them safe because Terran normally are very push-oriented. You can keep up with the harasses very easily with, obviously, Mutas and Zerglings. They're very mobile and make it kind of hard. It's a big decision for Qualifier Rice to either go to the bottom right or the top left, and there's a lot of counterattacks that are introduced by doing this.
Yeah, and you know what? I mean, Moon actually got creep almost to the gold, so he actually was able to really fortify his expansions if he needed to. But Qualifier Rice doing a good job scanning, taking a strong fortified position. Love the incorporation of a single Thor just to help zone out Mutas. Now, the Zerglings and Mutas did open up the bottom ramp here, but looks like the Marines are chasing and trying to push it out, and Qualifier Rice does end up pulling back. This is all, of course, a ploy, seeing if he can take a strong middle position because his fourth expansion, Gretorp, is done, and we were talking earlier about what happens when a Terran secures the gold.
The mineral income just gets absolutely ridiculous. It's going to be so helpful for Qualifier Rice. Where does he actually go from here? I love how he's taking center control and just staying safe. Right now, 3-3 and plus 2 for his weapons is being upgraded. A lot of Banelings here, but Moon is actually moving off of creep. He doesn't want to actually be fighting here, but this is going to be it. It looks like the Marines are going to be able to walk away. He's actually... Oh, no! The Banelings are actually trying to detonate him on a low ground. Bump into a lot of siege tank fire, and that's going to be the end of that. Moon, just like that, loses 40 supply. There's a drop in the bottom right-hand position. This is going to clean up a lot. It looks like units are nowhere near there. You should just actually range out this one hatchery, but it's going for the spine crawler. It's not going to be too advantageous. Now the Mutas are able to get over there. This hatchery should live, but still, I mean, Qualifier Rice just has all the momentum this game.
Yeah, I mean, Qualifier Rice does end up cleaning up, but he's moving across the middle of the map. He's got his plus two finish. He's starting plus three, plus three. He's got a great advantage. And taking this, oh man, this siege tank spread is sexy, Gretorp, and he is going to be able to take a strong position. Mews are going for a flank, though, and Qualifier Rice still should be able to defend Moon. Ooh.
Careful.
Does end up losing a lot, but got to be really careful with those Mews, man. They're so fragile, Gretorp.
Especially with that Thor in the field. That's like the scariest position ever. And look at this. I like what Amun's doing. He's just saying, okay, you want that position. It really doesn't do anything for me just yet. The third really isn't being mined from, so you can go and take that out. I'm going to go ahead and take all the reinforcements. Nice Baneling hits across all of these units. That's going to be able to take out the brunt of things. It looks like Qualifier Rice is moving over to the gold expansion. He desperately needs that. Of course, he wants to situate map control. More importantly, the planetary fortune is going to be so important at that position. It obviously establishes him a great expansion and gives him that center control. But what does Qualifier Rice actually do with the bottom right hand expansion and the top left? I said it before, Moon loves those spine crawler defenses, and it's definitely working out for him this time around.
Oh, we do see the huge flank of the army. The Banelings do manage to catch a lot of the units, and the Marines are pulling back. Qualifier Rice actually might have actually overextended his tanks. He actually loses a significant amount of tanks, and all of a sudden his push is slowed, but he looks like he has the gold base pretty secure at this point. The Mews are diving the Marines here, and Moon Oh man, every time I see those mutas die, man, my heart palpitates a little bit, Grievetor, because I'm like, dude, don't do it, man. It's like watching my friend trying to ask out the cheerleader in high school, man. I'm like, don't do it, man. I'm like, it's not gonna be good, but.
Never good. Oh my goodness. But 3-3 has just finished right now, Frodan. That's gonna give Quiet Rice actually a lot of time to take advantage of his opponent because Hive just finished, so another 220 seconds before 3-3 is actually able to be completed for the Zerg. The Marines are gonna be very strong against all ground. You can see the base in the top left-hand corner is under attack right now. And the Baleen Zergans are actually going to push in here. Can he actually do enough damage? Nice Marine spread. Ooh, nice Marine spread is going to do a lot. But, you know, it looks like he will eventually take out this one expansion.
Ooh, yeah, so, you know, keeping the expansion count down is definitely critical for Kawaii to succeed. Now, he does have a very strong supply advantage just because a lot of Moon supply were in things like Banelings and Zergans, very fragile amount of supply. Now, Kawaii Rice, when his upgrades are done, and he is going to be extremely fearsome. He's remaking his stores and tanks, and all of a sudden, I mean, just like we were saying, man, this center position is just so strong. Moon can't do anything without running into a huge pack of Marines, and looks like he is cleaned up here. Now, Kawaii Rice hasn't actually discovered a couple bases. He hasn't discovered the base in the top left just yet, but for right now, he's still sitting at a very strong advantage here, Gretorp.
Moon doing a good job, though, at picking off some of these siege tanks. But where can he actually go from here? I like how he's actually going for Ultra's tech, but he might have missed his timing for this. I normally go Ultralist Tech just to begin with. That's why we don't really see this brand of style ZBT on this map. You know, Zergling, Baneling, Muta is very tough, actually, because Siege Tanks can go in great positions. So a little bit interesting, but of course it is Moon style. Looks like the bottom right-hand expansion is under threat a little bit. Meanwhile, the third base is under attack. Here we go, though. Zergling, Baneling is going to be streaming forward. This is going to be very hard for Moon to actually engage on this.
Yeah, I mean, Moon is completely sandwiched out. He is completely, like, pushed out of his base here. He's not able to really capitalize on it. He's waiting for more forces, maybe for his ultras to hatch so he can engage in a full scissor. But the whole idea right now is Moon can't even bother to protect one of his core expansions. And right now, 10 ultralists are still in production. A couple are about to hatch here, Grievetor. But even if he breaks this, he's lost a lot of production. He's just lost two bases, and he's getting dropped at another expansion. And Moon's just constantly being pulled left and right. Kawaii Rice showing why he's a top TVZ player. And he might just try to see if he can go for a counterattack, but there are enough units here to defend. And no, instead, he's just going to be content taking the middle. It's just such an awkward spot here, Gretor, for Moon. I'm trying to feel for him right now because he can't really do anything against this huge army.
Well, let me tell you, these Ultras will definitely be a lot more helpful coming into this attack, but he's actually going to push forward without the plus three. Here we go, sandwiches from all the sides. Ultras are going to take the brunt of the damage. Now, finally, the Zerglings and Banelings are going to come in here, but a nice target fire on all the Banelings are going to just stop them in his tracks. The Marines are microing very nicely over here. Is it going to be enough, though? The Ultras look like they're dying just so fast, and there you have it. Moon's going to clean up, but after taking a lot of losses in that exchange.
Yeah, you know, Kawaii Rice tried to do, you know, a lot of kiting and actually managed to pick off several units here. Now, Kawaii Rice, he is just continuing to make more units, man. He's actually expanding to the top left as well, and looks like Moon trying to see if he can take the middle fortified position here, but just like you said, he threw so many units into the fray, and he's not really able to remax at all. He's got a lot of gas, but right now he's actually stuck by minerals. He doesn't have a lot of ability to just make units right now, despite the fact that he has larva. So it's just a very tough situation for Moon. He's trying to re-expand, and right now he has to hope that Kawaii Rice does something, but Kawaii Rice, he's banking. I mean, he's got so much money to remax, and Moon knows it. He's just going to charge for a Gretorp. He's going to send all of his Ultralisks, and Kawaii Rice doing a lot of damage here, not even really cutting with his Marines anymore, realizing that he has a very strong advantage, as right now Moon pressing in forward, doing whatever he can, but the Ultras will have to retreat.
I think the critical thing that Moon needs right now is the Infestor count. The Infestor count is so important in these battles. You want Zergling, Infestor, Ultralisk.
Yeah.
That's like the money composition, especially on a map like this. Also, the creep spread is so far in right now. He needs much better creep spread. Of course, Kawaii Rice has been pretty annoying with that at 9 creep spread as much as possible, so it does make the Ultra significantly weaker. We can see the top left expansion is found out. No, the Mutas! Ah! They're going to be picked off a little bit right here. But no way that this expansion stays up. And Qualifiers just yet again extending his lead ever so slightly. I love the planetary fortress that are set up in the middle of that, by the way.
Yeah, it's really clever there just to make sure to take strong positioning. Qualifiers doing very good. Just like you said, Moon needs infestors, man. He needs some way to deal with these Marines. He's running into the base again, but Qualifiers should be able to utilize it. In fact, you know, he's trapping his Ultralisk. If Qualifiers choose to move out, which he actually isn't at this point, he's just massing up units. That could have been a very dangerous situation, but Moon is throwing his units every which way. And I don't know if I agree with this. He's sending his Mutas, you know, haphazardly. He's picking off whatever he can, but I don't know. Moon's trying to make plays. He does end up taking this expansion out, but it's still not going to change things in the long run, as Qualifiers is still looking like he is not going to be moved anytime soon, Gretorp, from the middle of the map here.
No, there's no way. Qualifiers is going to set up. It looks like he has a ton of siege tanks. Let's go ahead and check the unit tap. 11 siege tanks on the field, 8 marauders, 44 marines. That is looking like such a scary death army, especially against an army that doesn't really have any infestors. Now find on the bottom right-hand corner will be cleaned up. All the spine crawlers are going to go down to these marine and marauder drops. But the big engagement is actually going to happen in the middle. I caught the last end of it. All the ultralisks actually go down so fast, the power of those siege tanks.
Yeah, I mean, Qualifiers even throwing in some snipes here and there just to weaken the Ultralisk. So at this point, Qualifiers has such a strong advantage. He is maxed. Moon is down to 70 supply. Moon trying to expand every which way, but the countdown is ticking, and you can expect Moon to just give up soon just because Moon, he can't do anything. Everything that comes out just dies immediately. He has nothing that can attack this force. Qualifiers has been doing such a good job denying creep spread, denying bases, denying ability to really set up your production line, and Qualifiers showing why his TPT should be feared even amongst the Koreans.
Yep, and taking down the last mining base from Moon. This is going to be it. Moon is going to be eliminated the first round of the next season qualifier. That is absolutely insane. Who would have thunk it, man? I mean,
yeah.
Qualifiers just smashing face all over the place.
And you know what, man? I mean, everyone was saying this is a new time for Moon because he can focus on StarCraft 2. And, you know, Qualifiers just going to go ahead and shut up a lot of people who are hating on him, just saying that, you know, he is not one of the tip-top players, but he is, man. He's here to stay. And his TVZ is definitely amazing at this point and showing great positioning as a lot of these tanks right now just in great job protecting them. And Qualifiers takes the game as Moon does call a good game, and he does advance through the next round with a 2-1 victory over Moon.
So congratulations to him. Let's talk about strategy a little bit. I'll let you go first, Frodan. What do you think happened in that game?
You know, well, I like the fact that Qualifiers, well, you know, was playing according to the map. He definitely, you know, tried to incorporate that three command center style on Antigua Shipyard, which is very, very powerful just because of the way, if you can set up that three base really safely, you can go ahead and take that fourth base. And, you know, around the 15, 17 minute mark, when Qualifiers took that middle expansion, he was just hard to move. He just replaced his supply so easily. Could saw how his middle income, it was 3,500 off of three base, and imagine just how much he could secure. Overall, was doing a good job. I like the fact that Moon was trying to expand all over the map as well, but just like we were saying, man, he's taking too much early game damage and was still not able to change any of that, as Qualifiers was able to set the pace from the get-go.
Yeah, I think one of the critical things is just the overall opening that Moon did. And we've kind of seen, you know, the Stefano style actually grow a lot more in popularity, especially on Antigua Shipyard. When center control needs to be contested, you want to take advantage of that, get the double upgrades in order to get a great creep spread, because creep spread, it goes along with double upgrades, that type of opening, mass circling, baneling, roach in the early game stages, tech to those infestors, and all of a sudden you have a good progression. So it's circling, roach, infestor, and then circling, roach, infestor, ultralisks, and that's a great thing. Also at that end game stage, I want to make it very clear to you guys how important getting that plus three carapace is, and we did not see that.
Yeah.
Plus three carapace is important because of those ultras. Having six armor on those ultras means that your opponent's marines only do three damage. Three damage is not a lot. I think it's three damage. So obviously with plus three upgrades to the marines. Having them deal four damage increases the marines' DPS by quite a considerable percentage. That is what, 33% increase in DPS? It's a lot of damage that you do. So obviously not having that plus three armor hurt him so much. The ultras are that much weaker. Marines are a lot more relevant in those fights. Rather than doing three damage, they're doing four damage. It lets them kill them so much faster. So I think that was a very critical mistake by Moon. Those two things really, you know, just the progression. Of course, the 32 banelings dying in the beginning, that hurt him quite a bit too.
That was such a poor trade, man. You could go to Wall Street with those kinds of trades. It was just, it was absolutely awful. I was like, man, these banelings can do so much. Nope, did nothing. And, you know, that just set Moon behind gas-wise. He couldn't harass with a lot of mutas. Of course, you know, he couldn't even afford anything like Infestor, you know, the infestation pit. So it's just a lot of those kinds of things is what sets you further and further back. And Quiet Rice, good job to not let Moon come back, as Moon, he's been showing that he tries to go for the immediate comeback, tries to go for something big play, was not able to do it this time. Kawaii Rice showing staunch defense and was able to take the game.
Definitely. So we're going to head into a break, and when we come back, Frodan, we're going to have JYP.
Yes!
JYP, man. And guess who he's up against?
Is he up against Gonzi?
Yes, he is.
All right. We'll be back, guys.
Be back, guys.